Good morning and welcome everyone to the 12th meeting of the Local Government Communities Committee. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones as meeting papers are provided in digital format tablets. You may see members using these during the meeting, so if you see members using electronic devices, I promise you that's what we're doing with them. I say that parrot fashion every meeting, just as a disclaimer. No apologies have been received. We've got a full house this morning, I'm delighted to see. And we move to agenda item one, payment to returning officers in Scotland. The committee will take evidence from a number of witnesses to explore the purpose and the appropriateness of providing payments or fees to returning officers for the conduct of elections in Scotland. And can I welcome Jonathan Shaffey, campaigns organiser, Electoral Reform Society Scotland. Navraj Singh Galich, my apologies for my pronunciation there, senior lecturer in climate law, University of Edinburgh. And Dr. Toby James, senior lecturer in British and Comparative Politics, University of East Anglia. Thank you all of you for coming along this morning. It's most appreciated. Indicated that no one wishes to make an opening statement, so we'll move straight to questions. Perhaps we can just state the most obvious question before we get to some of the technical aspects which we'll want to interrogate here today. But there obviously was a significant concern over the level of payments to mostly local authority chief executives in recent years, reported to being £1 million over the last 2 years, and those payments increasing and becoming more regular, particularly given the fact that elections used to be a once-in-a-while occasion in Scotland. But as evidence we have before us, and it's self-evident that in the last 15 years, pretty much there's been an election every year, and it has been known to be two elections in a year. That's a significant amount of cash going to what members of the public would consider to be highly paid, highly remunerated officials in the first place. There may be reasons for why they receive these sums. We wish to interrogate that further, but do you understand the public concern, and how would you comment in relation to that? Who would like to start us off? Dr. James.
Yeah, I'm very happy to. First of all, thank you very much for inviting me to give evidence to the committee. I entirely understand why the committee is interested in this and why there would be public concern about the amount of money which seems to be going to returning officers, especially at a time where there's widespread, if you like it, austerity in terms of the public sector, but also, most people are not seeing major increases in their own kind of income. I guess what I'd say, though, is that it's important to be aware that this isn't, if you like, a bonus that officials are taking. This is money which they are receiving for undertaking a particular task, and they do that independently from their position, and it's right, so there is a case for them being awarded money for that, but there's especially I think a case here for reviewing this, perhaps reducing the fee, redistributing the money, and I think one particular point, though, is that there's a severe lack of transparency in the amount of money that's going on here. There's figures cited in the BBC, for example, figures cited widely, I think that you're alluding to, tends to be the amount that they could claim for, and doesn't mean that it is the amount that they do claim for. And we don't know, as far as I'm aware, actually how much that money they are, if you like, taking as personal income, and what way they are looking to use that money for other things, such as paying their more junior staff for the overtime that they are doing. So I think I guess the key thing that could come from this is an increase in transparency, and that's something that certainly the committee could recommend here.
Okay, any of our witnesses want to add to that? Yep. Navraj Singh.
Thank you. I think I would endorse most of that. And I should actually start by saying thank you very much for the invitation, and apologies on my part for the lateness of my submission, which I think you've all received. One of the points I make in that document, in addition to what Dr. James has just said, is that returning officers are a key node in the delivery of this incredibly important function of electoral administration. And the responsibilities which they bear are statutory responsibilities, there are criminal and civil liabilities. So what they're So, which raises the question as to what exactly these monies are for. What are they being paid for? If they're being paid for their labour, then there's certainly an argument that says that well, this is a routinised job, which, as you said, Chair, convener, occurs at least in the last 15 years on an annual, sometimes a biannual basis. There are systems and procedures in place and staffs which are very considerable in experience and so on. So, from a labour perspective, it's not obvious that these are payments which are well paid. From a responsibility perspective, however, these are the officials who are ultimately responsible for the delivery of the election and are responsible if things go wrong. A different argument emerges. And I think that's where we might perhaps better focus our attentions. And that we might veer towards being risk-averse in how we move forwards from this, from the status quo. Do we want to start moving on the basis of public disquiet such as it is, or is there, as was just said, a need for a more substantial evidence basis about transparency of funds, but also other matters, before we make strong claims for reform?
Sir Shafi, do you want to
add
anything?
Yeah, well, first of all, thanks for inviting the Electoral Reform Society to the meeting. Our agenda is to bring democracy closer to people, that's part of it, but also to make it as transparent as possible and to build as much faith as possible between the people and the democratic systems and representatives involved in the democratic process. Now, I suppose there's probably two key points that we'd want to make. The first is that we do want to recognise the importance of the job. We do want to recognise some of the things that have been said previously around the responsibilities involved. But we also feel that we want these people, returning officers, to be seen as ambassadors driven by their ambitions for democracy and driven by delivering democracy for people. And therefore, we're concerned about the perception that people are involved in this process for high rewards financially. We think that's an issue of concern for the general public in the context that we live in today politically. So that would be one point that we want to raise. The other point is that this idea of people being close to democracy and close to the various processes around elections. And on that basis, we'd like to see there being some form of balancing around how much these individuals are paid so that people do feel a sense of proximity to the process as a whole. And I suppose also, because we're interested in strengthening democratic procedures, we'd like to think about ways in which resources can be funneled down the chain as far as possible to ensure that we do have a well-resourced democratic infrastructure. So I suppose they would be our key points in relation to the matters.
Can I come back to you in relation to transparency? So we don't know for sure at any election how much any individual returning officer receives. We don't know if they take it all. We don't know if, as permitted, they give money to charity. We don't know if they give it to lower grade staff who have to take on a lot of the work burden in relation to this. And that leads to a lot of concern because of the lack of transparency. Should all that information be captured on an annual basis, consistently and in the one place for members of the public to scrutinise and make a judgment call on themselves and whether they feel that is appropriate? Because with the absence of clear, identifiable information, that's what causes even greater anxiety and concern. So should that happen as a matter of course? And if it should happen, who would have the responsibility for doing it, given the fact that my understanding is that payments for local authority elections are driven by a COSLA process. For Scottish elections, it's now very recently the Scottish Government, but for UK and European elections, it's the Westminster government. So how do we pull all that together to get transparency? It seems almost set up to be as untransparent as possible. anyone want to consider those points? Dr. James.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I entirely agree about the lack of transparency, and this applies to this issue of returning officer fees, but also the wider funding of elections. My colleague Alistair Clark and I undertook a survey at the EU referendum, and we found that many officials lack funding for the conduct of elections, but also for the compilation of the electoral register. And there's no systematic process across the UK or in Scotland to collect this information. The Electoral Commission, the UK Electoral Commission, undertook a financial survey of electoral of local authorities between, I think, 2010 and 2012, which gave a really good picture of what was going on. But that project stopped and that project ended and didn't actually cover the particular issue that we're covering here today. So I entirely agree that there should be this systematic process in place. In terms of who does this, it could be the Electoral Commission could be well placed to do that, because they have, you know, they did invest a lot of time in developing a particular methodology for making this information transparent, and they've done that, if you like, for that period. So the Electoral Commission in Scotland could collaboratively do that with them.
Can I just say at this point, yes, Navarish Singh, I'll take you in, but if the answers are broadly similar, then you don't feel required to answer every question. But Najnav, can we take you at this point?
I mean, I think it very much depends on what it is you want this information for. I mean, and what information is required. Do we want information of transparency, if you want, on the aggregate sum that returning officers are receiving? Or do we want to know how much each individual returning officer is receiving and then what they're doing with it? Because those are two very different questions which require two very different sets of solutions. If it's the aggregate figure, then there one approach might be to for returning officers to be asked to inform perhaps the Electoral Commission how much they've received and what they've done with it, but the only the aggregate sum is disclosed. If it's the former, then you will require a much tougher non-voluntary scheme in which everybody's receipts are received. But of course, we don't ask them for what they receive in terms of their salaries, ordinarily, and this is akin to a salary. So it opens up quite difficult questions on this, on precisely this. And if it is going to be a non-aggregate sum, if it's going to be differentiated, there's the real risk that, A, it becomes a witch hunt. You know, such and such, it's well known, for example, that some chief executives give this particular sum to their to charity. So some are well known within their local authorities for doing that. Others don't quite reasonably. You can imagine where this sort of discourse goes. Secondly, for those who don't take all the money, there's going to be a pressure for them to do so in the future. So you're going to get some unanticipated consequences, which are deleterious.
Final question from myself and my fellow colleagues want in. You mentioned, Mr. Singh, the idea of it's akin to a salary. That begs the question, however, that if chief executives are doing the task of a returning officer, there's other duties that they can't carry out at that time. And there's a displacement effect, and they're receiving a salary from the local authorities, and that burden will fall on other staff within local authorities. Now, I think the evidence we've received is that elections and the returning officers have done exceptionally good jobs over the years, and we wouldn't want to undermine the success of that. So there's no idea of a witch hunt whatsoever from this committee, but we also want to make sure that when financial recompense kicks in, we know how much it is, we know where it's going. If it is a salary, we know what public officials are doing for that salary, and just as importantly, that lower-ranking public officials in local authority areas who may have to take on additional burdens as a consequence of that, they're also remunerated appropriately. So do you think that full disclosure on that basis would be helpful? Mr. Singh.
Full disclosure and transparency are really difficult to argue against, aren't they? I mean, there's an intuitive preference for it. But I nonetheless think that you need to be careful about how it's structured. And if the argument is everybody down the chain, everybody who touches the work should be appropriately remunerated. Nobody could disagree. I mean, that's obviously the case. Full transparency doesn't flow from that proposition, though. I would agree with the former. As to the latter, I'd want to have a much more worked out scheme, which is making clear how this operates. And indeed, whether it's operable or not, as you, I mean, I think in your remarks prefacing this question, you describe the multi-leveled nature of electoral administration in the United Kingdom and how difficult it will be to collate that information. So that
would any other witnesses like to add to that, Mr. Shafi?
Yeah, I mean, just to say that, you know, our approach is to look at democracy in an overarching sense. So when you look at the scrutiny that politicians are under in terms of pay, expenses and so on, we also think that transparency in terms of the structures and the processes that go with elections are as important, because it's about building public trust, not just in the representatives and not just in the debate that happens around elections, but also in the process itself. So, you know, for us, you know, while taking on board some of the difficulties that there may be involved, we want to see that transparency, and not least because we want to see how it could be made even more effective, because, you know, we do agree that the job that the returning officers have done has been a good one. But we also want to see how we can maximise resources and transparency in that is going to be vital.
Dr. James, do you want to add anything?
Just briefly, I think transparency it would be a very good idea in this area. If nothing else, I mean, this news story has become widespread, and it gives a perception, as I think we've already suggested, that you know, electoral officials, senior executives, are taking money, you know, when they should be there kind of promoting the democratic process. If in fact the reality is that this is money which is being received for electoral services, which are then redistributing and paying senior staff, then this could be a very positive thing for democracy, because it can actually alleviate and explain this to, especially in the current climate where there's considerable concern about you know, elites and executives and the role of government, you know, around the world.
Dr. James, Ruth McGuire.
Convener, good morning, panel. I'd like to explore a bit more this bit about remuneration. Both in the written evidence that we've received and a couple of you have intimated this morning that a good reason for this is that some returning officers pay their staff out of it, and that some of them give the money to charity. So I suppose my question is, should we be relying on the benevolence of highly paid officers to pay staff who are also involved in the process? And also, is it appropriate that these officers are deciding which charities public money goes to? So just to hear your thoughts on that.
Sure. I mean, if you were to... Thank you, sorry. If you were to start with a blank piece of paper, this wouldn't be the scheme that you ended up with, no doubt. A more rational scheme of reward would be ideally preferable. But it's the... And, you know, I don't think anybody would argue against that. I think the risk is the effect you have, the effect of the system integrity... When you start altering the system, when you start altering a key part of it, namely payments, now, it could be that, and I think it probably is not beyond the wit of humankind to come up with a system of payments which doesn't alter the integrity of the system, but it needs to be done carefully.
Yes, I mean, just on the issue of you know, paying the staff, I mean, it's worth saying that staff are routinely paid. You know, they aren't kind of volunteers, if you like. They have permanent positions, they have salaries. But what's happened in electoral services across the UK over the course of a number of years is that there have been these kind of built-up business process pressures. There's been an increase in late registration applications because it's become online and it's just become very seasonal. Everyone likes to do things at the last minute, naturally. Whether it's Christmas shopping, voter registration, you leave it to the last minute. At the same time, there's increasingly a number of people applying for postal votes. And so what you're getting at the time of an election is a lot of stress within electoral services. And that's leading to people doing extra hours, extra time, working long hours and beyond weekends. So where it could be the staff, that returning officers are using this money, you know, to pay their stuff, but we just don't know because that information is not kind of made public. And I guess I refer to all our previous points on that.
Mr. Shafi,
that sort of refers to the point I was making earlier around transparency also leading towards higher efficiency and towards maximising the resources available in electoral services. So I agree, and essentially would argue that it is about building as far and as deep as possible the idea that our returning officers and associated staff are really in this to deliver for the people and to deliver the democratic services, which actually there is a large, you know, a growing concern around members of the public having question marks over, especially as has been pointed out in the last number of contributions, especially as the political situation itself gets more and more terse.
Yeah, I don't think. Thank you for those answers. Nobody quite responded to the point about the senior officers deciding which charities those monies go to, and how that might be perceived by the public. I mean, we've all got our favourite charities, but it's public money that's being used in them.
Well, it's public. Sorry, if I may, it's public money, but if it is akin to salary, it's their money. And we don't second guess how they disperse their salary.
Yeah, I suppose though, convener, through yourself, that point was made as a good reason for keeping the current system in Alistair Clark's written submission to this committee. So that's what I'm probing.
Okay, sorry, thank you.
I'd like to add anything to?
Can I say something about transparency?
Okay. Mr. Singh,
I mean. I think we need to be clear about the burden we're putting on transparency. Is transparency a good in its own right? Do we want transparency regardless of the consequences, or does transparency lead to particular outcomes? We've heard it sometimes said that transparency leads to a greater efficiency or that it leads to greater public trust. Is that the case? I mean, just anecdotally, if you think about the regime for election expenditure and income, which was introduced by Papera, that's radically expanded the information that the public has, the transparency we have on how political parties and political actors receive income, how they expend that income, how they distribute it, and so on. Has public trust increased in that process? I mean, I would say that it's almost certainly not. That's not a reason for not having transparency, but it is a reason for being clearer about what work we want transparency to do and why we want it.
Okay. Ruth, do you want to come back on some of that?
Thank you.
Graham Simpson.
Thanks, convener. And thanks for attending. Mr. Singh, you said that we don't know the salaries of... chief execs. We know exactly what the salaries are, and they're all on six-figure salaries in Scotland. They're extremely well paid, and this is the nub of the question. They are very, very well remunerated people, and in the eyes of the public, this should be part of their job. They shouldn't be getting what Dr. James describes as a bonus. In fact, you said it's not a bonus. It is a bonus because it's in addition to what they're already getting. So the question really is, should they be getting paid extra for what many people would regard as something that should be considered to be part of their job?
Okay, thank you. It's clearly not part of their job. There's a statutory regime which has been created to... demarcate very, very clearly in the Representation of the People's Act, sections 23 to 27, that this is not their job. They have a separate range of functions and responsibilities which are separate from those of the chief executive of a local authority. So, no, it's not their job. It's an additional role which they've undertaken, which they undertake, which was previously undertaken in Scotland by sheriffs.
Dr. James?
And just to add to that, it's very valuable that it is separated because it insulates them from any other influences that they may have as being chief executive of their local authority, it's important that we do have electoral officials that are independent, that are not therefore subject to any other influences, and that run elections completely independently.
Mr. Shafi, do you want to add anything?
Nothing in particular to add. I mean, apart from the point I've been making throughout, which is that we want these individuals to be driven by delivering democracy and not by the sort of remuneration that you're referring to. That doesn't mean that we don't think these are jobs which deserve adequate pay, but we think that that has to be brought closer into what you refer to, the public good, and in particular the public's perception of that type of pay.
You'd hope they'd be driven in any case, given the high-powered jobs that they have. So, Mr. Singh, you rightly referred to the statutory regime. So I guess the question that flows from that is, should the statutory regime change so that it does become part of their job?
Well, I suppose that then there's also a broader question as to are returning officers, rather, the people who should be doing this job? In the acting qua chief executives, is there a broader argument, a broader need for an electoral management service which undertakes this role and a range of other roles? And this is a question which has been knocking around in Scotland and the United Kingdom more broadly for a number of years. The problem is that, I think, as we all know, as soon as one starts establishing a new bureaucracy to undertake this function, any cost saving or any cost avoidance that we might think we're making by taking away this £1 million or whatever it is from returning officers will be quickly swallowed by a new electoral bureaucracy. So you have to specify what the new regime might look like.
Dr. James?
And just to add that, I mean, I agree that it's important to keep the existing system in that sense. You could centralise functions within one organisation like the Electoral Management Board, but that wouldn't necessarily at all save money, because they would then need more resources. And if it's the public purse that we're focusing on here, then that's important. Research shows that sometimes electoral centralised bodies are more expensive. And actually having a local person on the ground who knows their constituency, knows their area, who knows the types of places where you can hold account, that it's appropriate, is really important. And when you centralise things too much, you lose that local knowledge, which is very valuable.
Mr. Shafi?
The last point that was made there about there being proximity and local knowledge being vital to the delivery of democratic services.
Mr. Simpson?
So one more question from myself. If we accept that it's councils that are best placed to carry out this role, and if you accept, and I don't necessarily accept this, that there should be extra money paid, should the money not then just go to the council and not one person?
Okay, there's a specific suggestion. Any reflection on that, Mr. Shaffer?
You'd have to rewrite the contracts of local government officials if you're willing to undertake that process.
I suppose none of us are suggesting that this would be easy, and that, you know, change has to be signposted and organised very carefully, but it's not a reason not to do the change. Mr. Shafi, did you want to?
Yeah, I mean, that I think is important. I think that, you know, when we're talking about the levels of resources we have to run elections and to make sure there's public faith in them, then we want to see that more, I think more efficiently, but also more broadly, distributed. And that, you know, the point you raise, you know, it's not going to be necessarily an easy process. I would underline as well that, you know, saying that we want to see these sorts of things happen doesn't mean that we're saying that the work that people have done up until this point has been invalid. I mean, I don't think that's anyone's position. But that, you know, we are very conscious of this building of public trust and of entrenching that. And that will take, as the years progress, there being a number of reforms, of which I think the point you make is a very valid one.
OK, Okay, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you. Convener, I have to say, in 37 years in politics, the first time I've ever heard that returning officers give away payments to charities or staff. And I'm fairly cynical, as I believe a number of my colleagues are, about this process. And the reason for that is that when I was in Glasgow City Council some years ago, I was talking about when the chief executive was retiring. Now, those days were fewer elections. And they said, well, he'll retire when in an election year, because the fee he gets counts towards his final salary, which means it bumps his pension up for, what, 20 years or whatever it happens to be. So you're not actually talking about, you know, a one-off payment here. It could be costing the public purse a significant amount of money for a number of years. And I have to say, I really can't see how it can be justified to pay, you know, the returning officer, who de facto is always the chief executive of the council, in my experience, what, £33,238 for the 2016 Scottish Parliament election. I mean, Mr. Shaff, you talked about being motivated to deliver democracy. That's more than any of the candidates were allowed to spend in that election.
I mean, I think absolutely. I mean, I think your contribution outlines the public attitude to this question. And, you know, there are dangers unless this is looked at and assessed, because, you know, it's one thing that people feel that they are not in touch with their politicians or their political representatives, which we know is a phenomenon. But it's quite another to feel that their democratic services and processes themselves are being undermined by, or perceived to be undermined by, the sort of thing that you talk about. And, you know, it is about the public really feeling, and this does relate to previous points made about local proximity, but really feeling in touch with how their elections are run, and really driving that into society as far as we can. So I would agree with the point made.
Okay, thank
you. I don't disagree. I mean, I think there's obvious reasons to be concerned here that you very eloquently kind of outlined, and so as a result of that, it makes sense to review the fees that are being paid. I guess I would add that we should be careful to think about, if you like, the UK-wide system, so we don't have a system that becomes over complicated, and we have one rule for Scottish elections and others for UK-wide elections, because it then becomes very difficult to administer. And this should perhaps, hopefully, kind of kick off the conversation across the UK as well. And just building on some of the previous questions, there is a strong case for diverting some of these fees, as it stands, to the from electoral from returning officers' services to expenses, as they're set out in the fees and charges order, because that would give make more money available for local authorities to conduct the poll. And I think the Association of Electoral Administrators have in the previous consultation responses to other inquiries, pointed out to the other things that could be covered as part of that, that at the moment local authorities are taking the brunt of the cost for example, postal vote applications that all kind of come in this crunch period in the run-up to election, last-minute registration deadlines that really places cost pressures on electoral services. It takes money from everything, from all the other important things that they provide.
Mr. Singh, do you want to add that?
Yeah, I would just, is it Mr. Gibson? Sorry, I can't quite see your nameplate. I've made exactly the point that you just made. Thank you. I've made exactly that point on the public record previously. I made it in my evidence, in my submission. I think that is a serious risk that goes to the question of public confidence in the system. But going the structural, and so the rates of these fees, I would completely agree, are appropriate for reconsideration. There's no doubt about that, I don't think. I think in one of the pieces of evidence from the one of the representative bodies of chief executives, they made a remark about these fees being in line with other positions of responsibility. But they don't say which positions of responsibility they're comparing them with. So I think that would be an area for exploration, a proper area for exploration. The other thing is, and this goes back to the previous speaker, if I may, if we're considering or mooting the idea of moving our overall responsibility for electoral administration to council officials, qua council officials, I think it might be worthwhile looking at the trajectory here. So, prior to 1977, there were sheriffs independence unimpeachable. After 1977, council chief executives operating qua returning officers to ensure their independence from the process. And then it would be local authority officials acting as local authority officials. That's I would suggest that that would be an unhelpful trajectory for the purposes of public confidence in the process.
Mr. Gibson, do you want to follow up?
Yeah, I mean, Mr. Singh, you know, in section 4 of your submission, page 6, you talk about Orkney and Shetland constituency, a turning officer charge as being £2,500. That's quite a diverse, obviously, geographic constituency. But Edinburgh was £16,548. I mean, is the workload 6.6 times higher for Edinburgh? And, I mean, when we go back to the figure for Glasgow, I mentioned the Scottish Parliament elections, you know, not only is it £33,238, which is significantly higher than the average salary in the UK, let alone Scotland, it's also more than, well, nearly £11,000 more than a turn officer earned for the UK general election. I realise there are one or two more constituencies in Glasgow at Holyrood level, but can these figures, how are these figures calculated, and how in any way can they be justified, Edinburgh versus Orkney, and the sums of money paid, for example, in Glasgow from one election to another? One can't imagine the workload is significantly greater. Sorry.
Thanks, Mr. Singh.
It's actually Mr. Garley, but never mind.
Sorry,
that's all right. No, that's fine. I can tell you how they're calculated. And they're calculated according
to the
charges order. So it's a very straightforward mechanical process, which I lay out in the two schedules to my submission and part two, I think. So it's a straightforward method of calculation. Whether it's justifiable or not, I think it is an open question. I wouldn't say that I'm competent to answer that.
Right, because I was going to ask each panel if they thought it was convenient.
Okay, so Dr. James, do you want to comment?
I mean, just briefly, just to say that the challenges are very different for running a poll in a very urban area to running in a very rural area. I don't think it makes sense to say it's six times more difficult, if you like. In some ways, there are more difficult and pressing challenges conducting a poll, finding polling stations, dealing with the types of logistical issues that kind of come up in more remote parts of Scotland. So it seems certainly that existing criteria doesn't make sense, and certainly my interviews and experience with attorney officers kind of reflects that.
Jonathan Chaffee?
Not much more to add. To be honest, I mean, I agree pretty much with the last comment that was made. You know, I don't.
Okay, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, convener. Thank you, gentlemen, for your comments so far. I have a real concern about this whole process. I feel, and I think the public do too, the perception is that there's an uncomfortableness about this whole element. From my experience over the last 18 years in a council, and I've been at every election during that time, an industry has started to grow within the council itself. You have a democratic services director. You have an election team that are working on a daily basis throughout the year to administer what's happening. Registration for postal votes is, I believe, dealt with through the valuation boards that take. So that's another arm of the organisation that's dealing with that. And as we get closer to an election, the individuals then come together doing their normal day job, which is administering an election. And the returning officer, whoever he or she is the overseer for the week before and on the whole 24-hour cycle of an election day when polling stations might be starting at 5 a.m. in the morning, and by the time the count's concluded, it's 5 a.m. the following morning. So I appreciate there's some antisocial process within all of that, but I still find it very difficult to believe that we are dealing with one or two individuals who are receiving the lion's share of the funding here, when in reality there's a small army of individuals doing the job and receiving no further remuneration for that job.
I think you've made a very good case for there being a wider distribution of financial resources. We want to see this pushed down the chain, and we want to see it in much of the way that you've actually outlined. You know, I think people do understand that there needs to be a wider layer of people involved in the process. I think the public would appreciate that process being better and more fairly resourced and not just concentrated into the hands of, financially into the hands of one individual. I actually think that's the direction of travel that we're moving in. I think the big questions that will come is how we actually begin to start thinking about that, how that would be implemented.
Mr. Galley, do you want to come in?
I think that there's a distinction to be made, to be drawn here between whether payments should be made and the level of payments. If I understand correctly, you're making an argument on the on the latter point. Yes. I would agree.
Yeah. Dr. James?
Just, I guess, a comment about, you know, the army, and if you like. And they are, there's big teams that are involved in running elections. One of the major changes that's been introduced across the UK has been the introduction of individual electoral registration, which has been a major business process change for everywhere. It's had cost consequences, it's made the process more expensive, and it's also placed a particular burden on individuals who have been doing this, and I've got kind of research that shows this. And a survey that was undertaken in February earlier this year shows that half of electoral officials, it's more broadly the army, if you like, have thought about leaving their position within the last year as a result of this. There's this high stress, high pressure, big turnover, and that is the environment in which elections, although they've been run very successfully in Scotland so far, could create problems and pressures where new staff, misunderstandings. So they need to be nurtured and they need to be looked after, and the army is as important as the commander, if you like.
And I think, Convener, following on from all of that, that we have to understand that, it, as you've indicated, it's becoming an annual performance, it's becoming an annual event. And we should be trying to do an audit trail of how successful it's being managed within an authority and to see if there really is value for money in the sums that are being paid to individuals who, as we've already heard, already receive a large salary in comparison with many. And the individuals who are in the army, as I've said, who do the work, are earning a fraction of the money that the returning officer has to be given. And you know, you cannot say it's anything else than a bonus, because it is a bonus on their salary for just administering something or overseeing, ticking a few boxes or having a look at the end of the day to make sure everything's sorted. You know, the army are people dealing with postal votes, the run-up to week before, 10 days before, just before the close of poll, etc. They're the ones that are having to deal with the pressure. You go to a count, and it's all now electronic in many respects in Scotland, or it's hand. But once again, there's an army of individuals who are being paid for that role to manage that situation. And the returning officer is doing less and less of the role and less of the management.
I think you make your point very well, Mr. Stewart. Does anyone want to reflect on that, Mr. Shaffey?
Yeah, can I just make one comment on that, which is that there's a strange kind of contradiction in a sense. We want to see pressure increase on electoral services and during the period of elections, because we want to see numbers of people engaging in elections increase. That means more people voting, more people doing it via postal votes, more people registering. So we want to see an increase in pressure, and that's why we think there needs to be a reaction to that. The two work hand in hand.
Dr. James.
Just to say, I mean, a theme throughout that comment and throughout the committee so far has been that this is it's increasingly become an annual event, it's become more routine. That is so, but it's also a process that at the same time has become more complex, because we have a greater variety of elections, different types of electoral systems, different types of ballots, more complex laws, 30 or 40 laws that returning officers have to kind of be aware of when they go into the electoral process. There have been recommendations by the law commissions to simplify this and make this much more routine. But I guess it has to be recognised that there is a degree of complexity for the for the returning officers, but also for staff, that has become more of a problem.
Sir Galley, do you want to add anything to that?
Not at this point, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Andy Wigan.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for coming in this morning. I think people on the whole think that chief executives run elections. They see them at the count and they think that that's the returning officer as the chief executive. I think there's quite a bit of trust in the system. I don't. There've been problems in past elections in 2007, for example. It's only when it comes to the money, I think, that people have begun to ask a few questions. But just to clarify, the Registration of People Act makes it clear that the local authority shall appoint an officer of the authority. So it need not be the chief executive, could be any officer of the authority. I'm just wondering whether, well, I've got two questions, really. One is, do the returning officers actually do this job in their own time? And secondly, there doesn't appear to be any statutory provision for anyone other than the returning officer who, for example, deputies who have similar levels of shared responsibility to get any remuneration. That relies on the benevolence of the returning officer thinking that they should perhaps get some if it's been a particularly difficult election or whatever. So I wonder if you can clarify that latter point and also say if you know whether, in fact, returning officers are doing these jobs in their own time.
Dr. James?
In terms of our, you know, our returning officers doing this job in their own time, it's very difficult to know or measure that. What I can say is that, having done interviews with electoral officials, a current theme is that many returning officers are very hands-on, proactive, and do get, you know, roll their sleeves up, get involved in this, and are involved in the management kind of process, you know, the location of polling stations and the like. Whereas some others are more content, although they can't, you know, devolve responsibility formally, do use, you know, kind of middle management staff to do this for them. I mean, it's impossible to do that. I mean, obviously, this job is only one half of the process, if you like. I mean, a select committee, I think a Westminster select committee, did look at the issue of chief executive pay, I think a couple of years ago, and that's a report that the committee might find interesting as well, because that's the other side of the coin, if you like.
Any other witnesses want to add to that? Okay, no, Mr. Reitman, do you want to follow up on any of that?
Okay, fine. I mean, I think the question is, obviously, as Mr. Galley made clear at the beginning, that the responsibility in this post is considerable. There are liabilities that are faced if things go wrong, and people need to have a trust in the system. So I don't think anyone's questioning the fact that existing returning officers are not trustworthy in any way. But I think there is a question mark over the extent to which existing returning officers who tend to be chief executives are seen as independent returning officers, and by the public, and the money highlights that question in their minds. It's something we'll reflect on as to whether, in fact, the law should perhaps be changed such that there's greater flexibility in who can be appointed. For example, somebody outside of the council, a retired chief executive, for example, so there's greater flexibility. I'll leave it there.
Anyone want to reflect on that comment?
Yeah, I mean, if I may say that I think you're right to point out that it's not that people distrust returning officers, it's that people distrust people who get loads of money. I mean, to be quite blunt, right? And, you know, a lot of our research is based on, you know, the relationship between people's incomes and their voting patterns, and if indeed they're even registered to vote. You find that the lowest voter registrations and lowest turnouts at elections are often coincide more often than not with those areas of lowest income. So when we're talking about money, when we're talking about financial remuneration, that really is the sticking point. And actually, when you think this through, it's much better, it's much more efficient to have that money properly spread to the various arms of the services that we've discussed already this morning. And I think that does help to breed the sort of confidence that you're talking about. I would also say, just lastly, that I think a lot of what we are seeing happen around the discussion around democracy in more general terms is that democracy is constantly evolving.
democracy and the process of democratic institutions, structures and processes doesn't really have a full stop. We are constantly looking at ways in which we can improve and adapt. And one of the things that you have to do as part of that process is to look forward and work out and try to make some forecast as to where problems might emerge. And one area where problems may well emerge in a much more public fashion is around what you talk about, there being this sense of the financial remuneration being too high, not spread enough around the service.
Mr. Galley?
Thank you. To Mr. Whiteman's first question about could it be somebody other than the chief executive or an officer akin, there is, of course, a statutory expectation that it will be the chief executive. In my note, I refer to the expression of the secretary of the Undersecretary of State at the time that was the appropriate official. So that, I think, answers that point. I think on the question of whose time this is occurring in, I think that's a really good question in the sense that chief executives are already incredibly busy doing a large role of high-pressured work. On top of this, on an annual, biannual, or whatever basis, they then have to, in addition to that, do this enormously responsible job of running the democratic process. In what time is this occurring? Are they working 24-hour days? How much of this work is deputed? My concern about this is that it's a rather masochistic approach to the labour market, which I thought we'd given up on, really. You know, we don't think it's valuable for people to work all the hours that God sends just to demonstrate their worth. So if you were to make an argument that this is a professional job of great responsibility which needs to be done properly, this isn't the way you would do it. That would be an argument. It becomes too pressured and so on and so forth. Then there's the other question about diffusing or devolving the money. The money, I don't think, is paid for labour. This was my opening remark. It's not paid for the quantum of work that you do. It's paid for the responsibility which flows from the job. That the responsibility does not flow down. It rests with the returning officer.
Okay, thank you. Dr. James, do you want to add anything?
Just briefly, I think that though there may be arguments and there's legal impediments for giving the role to someone else, one advantage of the returning officer being the chief executive is that they have obviously a sense of informal kind of managerial kudos within the organisation. If the chief executive says something, by and large, smaller units will feel as if they need to do that. When it comes to elections within short time period, within pressured time periods, giving additional staff, providing extra resources, that can make a big difference, and it has some added value there.
Okay, no, we're really going to have to move on because we're running a bit late. No, because Aileen Smith wants in as well. Sorry, Mr. Whiteman. It's an interesting line of questioning, but we'll have more evidence sessions for the witnesses that are waiting for the next evidence session. We'll run this for maybe another 10 minutes or so, and then we'll conclude there. Aileen Smith.
Thanks very much, convener. Actually, just picking up on the previous point before I come to something else I wish to ask, it did occur to me that with such big responsible jobs that chief executives have and they're remunerated accordingly, how on earth do they then have the time to do this? What else loses out when they are? So I think that's a point that Mr. Galley had raised there, and it's something that we need to be thinking about. On Mr. Galley's evidence, could I specifically ask on page 6, you talk about it's part of a section that talks about the complications in England and Wales, but you mention here that the job of returning officer is a ceremonial ex officio role. Does that mean that it's unremunerated then? Could I ask specifically that?
No, it's ex officio, but it's not ceremonial as such. But it continues to be remunerated on the basis of the charge order.
Okay, thanks. Sorry, I used the word ceremonial because that's what you had in your submission to us.
But I also say that it's that in certain circumstances it's ex officio certainly, and in certain circumstances it's deputed down.
Sorry, it's definitely...
It's deputed down.
Okay.
In England and Wales. So there's a different regime in England and Wales.
But it's still paid. Mm. So bringing us back then to the paid role of this, and the point that you also made, Mr. Galley, about the whole thing being about responsibility, perhaps, rather than labour. In that regard, are any of the panel aware, and thank you all for coming this morning, I should have said that first, but are any of the panel aware if there have been any sanctions? And if we look at problems that we know about over the years, such as boxes lost at sea, issues with postal votes, the first time the electoral counting system was tried, for example, mm-hmm. we have seen problems and issues. So have there been any sanctions at all? Does anyone know?
I think Dr. James is the expert here.
No pressure, Dr. James.
off the top of my head, I'm not aware of there being of the data on that. I mean, I think that's something we certainly be worth kind of collating. But it's certainly the case that electoral officials, returning officers, have been within the court, you know, subject to the courts. In the case of Tower Hamlets electoral fraud inquiry, for example, initially the returning officer was put before the courts in that case. But I'm not sure of whether the Electoral Commission, how many cases they have stopped the fee going to returning officers for, but I'm sure they can tell you next week.
Thank
you. More broadly, that I think this goes to the question of the evidence base. But I think that there's a real need for a far more detailed knowledge of exactly what goes on, whether it's relating to the specific point you just made, or the sums which are paid out, or the lever of superannuation which attaches to them, which I think was a point made by Mr. Stewart. I think we just need to know more. And these are the right sorts of questions, I would say.
Thank you. Also, on the Electoral Management Board, I don't know how much is known about that, and it obviously only covers the administration of local government elections. Is that something that might be able to be expanded? I think, Mr. Galley, you talked about if we were to set up independent systems, then, you know, there might be a lot of work in that, more red tape, perhaps more funding. But is that something that perhaps is there and could be looked at to see whether there's possibilities?
It could certainly be looked at. I think this was a matter which has already been looked at after the electoral difficulties in 2007, which you referred to. These were amongst the issues which were surveyed. I would have to. I think it might be worthwhile asking the people who are more intimately involved in that process as to what consideration they gave to this issue. And why it would be appropriate to revisit that issue so soon again.
Okay. Thank you. Convener.
Just before we draw to an end here, it's worth just clarifying something, because, of course, we will have chief executives before us to give their views on it. And they'll be crucial, because they've done the job on the ground. Already today, we've heard concerns in relation to transparency over payments. We've heard concerns over the level of payments, over the consistency of payments, over the workload that may or may not be involved by returning officers, what they may not do if they're doing that workload, the army of soldiers on the ground that Alexander Stewart referred to that may not be compensated for the additional work that they have to do. So we are seeing that elections are run very, very well in Scotland, but is it also reasonable to say that this does have to change? So the systems of payments somehow has to change. Would we get consensus in relation to that? If not, exactly how payments to returning officers or whoever else are done, but the system does have to change. Mr. Shafi, can we start with yourself?
Yeah, I mean, I'll just be very short, yes.
Okay. Mr. Galley?
I think the system needs to be better justified. And if appropriate justifications aren't forthcoming, then it has to change. But justification, I think, is the starting point.
Okay, so more scrutiny at the moment, Mr. Galley, more better understanding of what's going on, and then potentially change in the future. But let's wait and see what the evidence shows.
Exactly.
Okay, that's helpful. Dr. James?
I would probably agree. I think transparency is something that could happen very quickly, at low cost, and you would immediately clear up provide us with the information to undertake some wider review. But I think it's worth stressing that there's a need, I think, to review not only this area of how much money returning officers are receiving, but actually some of the pressures that are going on underneath there as well, and reviewing the overall situation here.
I don't know also if you're aware that the Scottish Government has said there'll be an elections bill in the lifetime of this Parliament. Might that be an opportunity to scrutinise some of this further and see whether on a Scottish level we can provide more consistency and transparency?
I would just say, I mean, yes, I think that one element that you should also consider is actually to do some engagement with members of the public over the issues. You know, I think it's good to hear from, you know, folk involved in this, you know, professionally, to hear from chief executives, be quite interested to find out, and actually we might do some work on this, thinking about it, to find out what the attitudes of the general public are in relation to this, and get some evidence on that.
I don't know if Mr. Galley or Dr. James wants to add anything before we bring the session to a close.
I could clarify Ms. Smith's point about ceremonials, but I could do that off the record if that's preferable.
I'm happy for you to
contact the clerk. Sorry, I just found that point in the text that you referred to. So in England and Wales, the returning officer as such is a county sheriff or a chairman, of a chairperson of a district council. But the acting returning officer, who is a council official, actually does the job, and they are the person that's remunerated.
Okay, thank you. And Dr. James?
And just in some ways, building on that, I think it would be an excellent idea to, you know, for there to be a further inquiry based around the potential of being some Scottish elections bill. But I guess there's also this issue of trying to develop systems that don't jar with the UK, with the wider UK context, so that we're not asking electoral officials to kind of work, if you like, to two sets of too many sets of electoral laws and practices as well.
Well, all that remains for me is to thank all three of you for coming along here today. Can I make an appeal? Do follow the further evidence sessions that we take, and if there's any additional points you want to make, please don't hesitate to get in contact with us and help inform the conclusions that we'll eventually come to in relation to this short inquiry. Can I thank all of you again, and can I suspend briefly for a moment? Thanks. good morning, and welcome back to the Local Government and Communities Committee. Prior to the previous item that we just heard evidence in relation to the payments to returning officers, I should have taken agenda item one first, which I didn't do. So I'm now going to do that formally now, and that's decision to taking business in private. The committee is asked to decide whether to agree to take item six in private, if that would be agreeable to the committee. Okay, thank you. Just wanted to do that formally to keep ourselves right. So we now move to agenda item three, which is subordinate legislation, parts 2, 3, and 5 of the Community Empowerment Scotland Act 2015. The committee will undertake a second evidence session, parts 2, 3, and 5 of the Community Empowerment Scotland Act 2015. There's 9 Scottish statute instruments, SSIs, relating to part 2, community planning, and part 5, asset transfer requests. They were laid before Parliament on the 10th of November 2016. Further SSIs relating to part 3 participation requests are expected to be laid later in the year rather, and therefore evidence relating to this section will refer to regulations which are currently in draft form and will feed into its formal scrutiny of the final instrument. So that said, can I welcome Assistant Chief Constable Andy Cowie, Local Policing North, Police Scotland, Sandra Holmes, Community Assets Sector Lead, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Iona Colvin, Director of Health and Social Care, North Ayrshire, NHS Ayrshire and Ayrne, Bruce Kylo, Head of Policy and Planning, Strathclyde Partnership for Transport, and Richard Davidson, Strategic Manager, Scottish Natural Heritage. We're not having any brief opening statements from witnesses this morning, given the size of the witness panel that we have today. So we'll move straight to questions and Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. Welcome, witnesses. The statutory instruments we're looking at relate to community planning and asset transfer, and a draft one on participation requests. How significant do you think, in general terms, these powers contained in the Community Empowerment Act are for your organisation's work in general? What do you see as the benefits, and what do you see as some of the challenges in implementing the new legislation?
Okay, who'd like to go first on that? Sandra Holmes is the first to catch my eye. Okay. Thank you, Sandra.
I'll kick off. Thank you.
That's just a note. I can be a bit absent-minded. Please do make an effort to catch my eye. I won't be ignoring you, I promise, Sandra. Yes.
Certainly within HIE, we very much welcome the direction of travel to encourage us to continue to support communities and to make any engagements that we have with communities meaningful and relevant to them. We've got a unique remit that includes working alongside communities as well as our work to promote businesses. We see the sort of step change in having the sort of statutory framework really to give communities confidence that when they engage with us, we'll take due consideration of their input and we'll reflect on that and engage appropriate with them. So we very much welcome the direction of travel.
Okay, anyone else want to come in there? Iona Colvin.
Oh, thanks. I think it builds on some of the duties that we have in the Public Bodies Act. And as Director of Health and Social Care, obviously I'm very interested in that in terms of how we develop the duties that we have there. And in North Ayrshire and Ayrshire and Arran, we've been developing our locality planning approach. So we've got a significant piece of work that we've done both within the Community Planning Partnership but also within the Health and Social Care Partnership, which is really the delivery of the health service in the community. And so it's been building on that. We've had a number of successful events in terms of locality planning events, which have then fed into the development of our strategic plan for the priorities for health and social care and wider into the Community Planning Partnership. So it's building in that direction, but we're trying to meld that together along with the requirements in the Public Bodies Act to involve professionals, particularly general practitioners and other health professionals, in determining those priorities. So we've now established basically locality planning with GPs involved, with integrated joint board members involved, which is a range of people from elected members of the council through to staff representatives who are chairing those committees. And that's been a really interesting development in terms of communities identifying their priorities clearly and alongside medical practitioners and other practitioners who deliver the services, but also feeding into the whole area about communities of interest request as well. So we've had a number of participatory budgeting events, and we've had a number of, we will have also in the spring, a communities of interest one around mental health, because mental health has come through in the whole of North Ayrshire as a significant issue for every community. And what I'm thinking is that this legislation then allows that maybe to develop further in terms of how we look at the delivery of some of those services in the future and the ownership of some of the assets.
Thank you. Andy Cowie.
Thank you. I suppose the one word that would come to mind is opportunity, and it's using the new Act to build on the strong partnership ethos that we've had right back to 2003, the original community planning, when that came into being. And I suppose I would anchor that against two particular things. One is simplifying some of the bureaucracy within planning. So under the Police and Fire Reform Act, as you're well aware, there's a requirement for local police plans in the 32 local authority areas. And we have seized the opportunity of the local outcome improvement plans that came out of community empowerment to simplify that. So therefore, instead of having silo organisational local policing plans, the direction of travel that we now want to move in is to having these local policing plans much more integrated, or part of the LOIPs, as they're called. So that simplifies it, because I think to be authentic as an organisation, we would kid ourselves if we think that we solve any problems on our own. It's about working together, and that has been the tradition within Scotland. So it's actually seizing that and making it simpler for ourselves and for partners to work together to deliver community benefit in that wider aspect. So that's one opportunity. The other bit is around localism and being responsive to local communities. And I think that participation options and requirements on us really builds on the direction we want to move in, which is about empowering our officers and staff within the organisation to be more responsive to those local challenges and opportunities, as it's worded in the Act. So there's a real chance to build on some of the strengths, because we would see that actually there's a lot of strength in community engagement already, but this takes it to the next level. So it's not forgetting about those strengths, it's about enhancing them and moving it forward to the next level.
Bruce Kylo.
Well, thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to come and speak to the committee this morning. You may be aware SPT has been a community planning, statutory community planning partner since 2003, and we found it to be a very useful process for us to engage both with local communities and third sector bodies, but also the wider family, council family, etc. And that's something that we've done and have been glad to do over the last 13 years. One of the ways that we've done that is through annually producing what we call transport outcome reports, which is a detailed information for each local area. They're available to all members of the CPP, all local councillors, and we put that up on our website. And that's just our way of trying to demonstrate the value locally of the SPT services that we provide. For example, you'll be aware, transport is strategic, and often cross-boundary bus services don't observe local authority boundaries. So it's sometimes a challenge for us to try and get things down to a local level, and that's something that we're very aware of, is going to the locality planning. But that's something that we do try to convey through, you know, for example, we run the Glasgow Subway, and although that's something that's based within Glasgow, people from other council areas do use it, so people in North Lanarkshire, etc., do get the benefit of that. So I think there's the current community planning system works very well for us. We welcome the Community Empowerment Act. I think there probably just a wee note of concern would be around the fact that, as I say, we are strategic, regional, cross-boundary, and the ability of organisations like ourselves and other regional or national bodies to break things down to a very small local level to demonstrate the value that we're delivering in that very small local area is something that we would just note a note of caution on.
Okay, thank you. Richard Davidson.
Yes, we also welcome the broader, stronger framework that the Community Empowerment Act provides. We've always felt that community involvement, engagement and empowerment is really important from an environmental point of view, and a lot of communities do very good work around environmental issues. So we would hope that this framework, these rights for community bodies to get more involved in these sorts of issues, is a really powerful one. You know, it's not without one or two challenges from our point of view, a bit like Strathclyde Passenger Transport Executive. You know, SNH is a national body. We have to deal with a lot of communities, a lot of local authorities and all community planning partnerships. But it's very much an opportunity rather than a challenge, if you like. There are far more opportunities coming out of this to put the environment more at centre in how community planning partnerships work, for example.
Okay, so that gives us a context. Mr. Whiteman, do you want to drill down on some of that?
A couple of specifics, but I'll come back later, perhaps.
Okay. Can I maybe ask in relation to the evidence session we had previously, where we were looking at asset transfer requests, and it was quite easy when we were thinking about the local authority for what that might mean. But I suppose the variety of organisations we have in front of us today, I would be interested to know, have you thought about what that might mean in relation to the facilities or land that you have? And have you given thought to assets that the community might be interested in taking more control over or ownership of? I'll take Bruce Kylo first and then Richard Davison.
Yeah, absolutely, convener. I think from our point of view, we've been very grateful to the colleagues in the Scottish Government who have taken account of our views in the legislation. For example, Glasgow Subway is an operational piece of railway. We wouldn't want somebody coming in and requesting that one of the stations was transferred to them, although we do try to work with the local communities, obviously. So I think from that point of view, there are national strategic pieces of infrastructure that need protected. It would include the subway, and that would include our bus stations as well. We do have other land that we've got available, and that's something that we'll happily put up on our website and let people know about. But I think you'll be aware that sometimes transport projects can take many years to deliver, both in the planning and getting the funding together. And that's something that I think is important to remember, that we may want to hold on to a piece of land because of the wider, longer-term strategic need for it. For example, old rail solums, which may need to be opened up at some point in the future, or pieces of land which may be needed for a park and ride, or that sort of thing. So I think there is huge opportunities for local communities. I think one thing that we'd say about it is that we would like to see a strong emphasis and responsibility placed on the community body when they're applying to an organisation like ourselves or NDLs, when they're asking, so that it was clear, demonstrable need for that land, a good governance structure within that community body, and something that allowed us a level of reassurance in being able to deal with that organisation and from a legal point of view. So we again very much welcome the opportunity it provides, but just from a strategic transport point of view, very keen to protect the infrastructure that we have.
Okay, Richard Davison.
Yeah, in our case, our main assets for asset transfer would be nature reserves that we own, or buildings. Our board last week approved what's quite a long title, but a rural land asset management plan, which basically reviewed all of our nature reserves that we do own and look at the opportunities for engaging with communities about transfer of assets to them and what sorts of issues would arise from that. So adopting what we hope is a pretty positive, proactive approach to that.
Okay, that's helpful. Sandra Holmes.
I think when asset transfer is talked about generally, people tend to think about sort of local authority assets that are surplus to requirement, and this is changing things onto a new footing. It's very much putting the sort of the power in the hands of communities to come forward to any public authority to request not only to purchase but also to lease or to use or to occupy public assets, buildings or land at any time in the future. For High, we've got quite an extensive property portfolio, mainly built assets, and they're very much for us productive assets. We don't really have anything that we would deem to be surplus. So we'll have a range of business units. Most of these will be units that we've actually constructed, and then we seek to get tenants to come in to create economic opportunities. We also have sites for development, and we're looking at those quite strategically, looking at getting the most productive use out of that site. And then we've got a range of operational offices as well. We have recently, in April of this year, we actually amended our disposals policy to better reflect the forthcoming requirements of asset transfer. And we've introduced best value decision making when we seek to dispose of our assets. So we will frequently put assets onto the market.
Our default position has always been when we've got a tenant in one of our buildings is to offer the asset at market value terms to the tenant. And I think it's important to recognise that businesses develop economic and social benefits, as do communities. So we introduced the asset transfer policy. And the asset transfer policy was then, if there was a community interest in any of the assets we were seeking to sell or to lease, we would then look at our decision-making on a best value judgment, looking at taking account of the wider non-financial benefits that the bidders were going to take forward, and again, including businesses alongside communities in that. We've had one example when we were seeking to lease an asset, and we went through the process, and in terms of the bids that we received, we only actually received one bid, which was from a community organisation, and that was a lease that went to that community through the asset transfer process. We've currently got a live case at the moment where we've got one business interest and two community interests over a single piece of ground that we've got, and we're just going through the assessment process there. Within High, we've also provided grant assistance to communities to secure assets, either from ourselves, but more so from other organisations, private and public. And we've got an example where we supported a community in Tyree to purchase a business unit from ourselves, and they now have their own premises in that business unit, and they've also got other tenants, and it's a way of generating income for the local community. So I think it is important to see that these are productive assets as well as surplus assets, but productive assets can do very well in community hands as well as in other hands.
Thank you. I don't know if Iona Colvin or Andy Cowie wants to follow up on any of that.
Yeah, I mean, it's an opportunity there for ourselves. I suppose contextually, as you refer to, convener, the new Chief Constable has put in place collaborative work to develop a 10-year strategy, which is called 2026. And that's obviously looking at what service we're seeking to deliver with communities and partners moving forward. And that will be going out for public consultation in January, February time next year. And the estate is an enabler of delivering service. It's not the other way around. So therefore, as an organisation, we are looking internally, first of all, at seeing what are the current demands for the estate from the public, from ourselves, and from that working through, there's a huge number of collaborative opportunities where with other public sector bodies and other people, we can actually share roofs and actually work closer together. And we've seen examples in Aberdeen of a community hub, and there's all sorts of opportunities out there. So we're seeking to gain early change opportunities, and there's a number of consultations out and about with people looking at that locally. But given the geography of Scotland, we will always need to have bases for our officers to patrol from. They need to turn up and change into their uniforms and get their gear on, and out they go. So we will always need a wide geographic spread of that. The Scottish Police Authority own all our premises, so it's actually a decision for themselves around what happens with them in longer term. But at the moment, we are looking at our estate, and again, on the back of 2026 and that public consultation, thereafter, once we're clear and agreed within Scotland about what we're trying to do as a police service, then we have to look at the estate. So that will be coming out for wider public consultation later on in 2017. And asset transfer is going to be built into the processes there, because obviously we have over 420 operational buildings within Scotland and across the length and breadth. So we will build in the asset transfer policies into that to make sure that's encompassed.
Yeah. Iona Colvin, how would we look at health and social care partnerships in the context of asset transfer? Where would they sit?
Yep. So I think the work that we're doing just now is going along that direction in terms of working with all partners within communities. I'm thinking just now specifically about the island of Arran, for example, where we're working with all the partners within the island to look at the use of the totality of the assets that are owned by the NHS and the council, because none of it's owned by the partnership, and to look at how we use that in the future. And particularly in this instance, we're looking at how we use the hospital in Arran. And I think as you go forward, I think you can see opportunities maybe to also look at parts of that estate being used by other parts of the community for different reasons. Highland have actually done quite a lot of work on this and have done a number of community asset transfers in terms of the services that they have. So I'm thinking about, I think, Loch Inver and a couple of other places in Highland where actually they've worked with community groups to look at the community groups then taking ownership and running services in the more isolated communities. So that's something that we would want to learn from and to look at as we move forward with the model.
Okay, that's very helpful. The number of bids from MSPs for supplementary questions. Now, we're trying to stick with asset transfer here so we can do it in a theme. Now, Alexander, should you be the first to indicate, is it on asset transfer
yes,
or should you take it later?
It does cover that. And I'd like to cover that. And I want to specifically deal with the Assistant Chief Constable on it, because in your submission, you talk about responding to the needs of communities that lie at the heart of Police Scotland. And I think we would expect you to say that in your submission. If it wasn't in your submission, we'd be wondering why not. And when we're looking at the challenges that you face, and you've gone into that in the last answer about the complexities that we have of the buildings you have across your estate now, when that opens up some real challenges for you, but it also opens up some real opportunities. And when you're having some negotiation, and I'm aware that negotiation and consultation is taking place across some communities at the moment, and there is some criticism from within that, because some people see it as an erosion, a removal, or a loss. And it's how you balance that, because with that came confidence in some communities about your role and your responsibility. And if that does change and there is a removal, there's a loss, or there's an erosion, then that has an impact on the community that you're left with trying to manage and represent. So your views on that would be interesting.
That's very specific to Mr. Cowie.
I think the question, quite rightly, is framed around service and erosion of service, because service is actually delivered by people, not by buildings. And I suppose, you know, we all have to manage whether it's a household budget or an organisational budget around that. And it makes no sense to have a building if we're only occupying one of three floors and it's costing an arm and a leg because it leaks like a sieve. To maintain that, if there is a smarter option, a more collaborative option in that vicinity. And that's what we're seeking to seize in these change opportunities as we're depicting them. But the important thing is to remember is that it's still local officers that will be deploying to members of the public. 95% of our calls come in through the telephone, and officers are deployed around that. And the feedback that we're getting is that people want to see the officers and to have that service delivered. So it is a balancing act, absolutely, around being able to fulfil our statutory duty. But also in the opportunities here is there a wider public benefit under asset transfer? And that's one of the ones that we're exploring with government officials as well. Is it's down to the accountable officer, apparently, within the SPA to make that decision around what's best value, public benefit versus the requirement to maintain our statutory function and receive that capital receipt. And it's going to be challenging there. I mean, you could envisage the situation where you have a couple of competitive community bids for premises or for a lease, and then how do you weigh up the public benefit around that? So I think, as the previous speakers talked about, I think a lot of that thinking will evolve as we go through some of the early examples of that, but it's about service delivery and how can we do that in a joined up way within the budget we have.
Thank you, Kenneth.
Thank you for that. Lots of supplementary asset transfer. Kenneth Gibson.
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah, specifically to Sandra Holmes. I mean, one of the concerns that was raised last week in evidence was the horrendous amount of time it takes to negotiate some of these transfers. We heard of one case where apparently there was a willing buyer and a willing seller, but 5 years later, nothing apparently had happened. That was a local authority case. Now, you obviously have a lot of experience in the Highlands and Islands of this. I'm just wondering, you know, what you're doing to overcome that, you know, in order that community organisations don't become disheartened by the length of time it actually takes to negotiate these transfers.
I think it's fair to say that any community acquisition or asset transfer is sometimes measured in months and years rather than weeks. Mm. Part of the process, it really depends where the community is starting from. If a community's got a very clear identified need and they can articulate that need, and they can then identify an asset that can then help them deliver that need locally, and then they're able to negotiate with a willing seller, things can go through quite quickly. Invariably, though, it will take some time for the community to actually develop the case, and that's where work of Highlands and Islands Enterprise alongside our partners can actually really help the community capacity building, and that's a big part of the process. I do think that the asset transfer provisions provide a framework for authorities to work to. It isn't the only route. If a public authority is looking to dispose of an asset, it isn't mandated that it has to go down the asset transfer route. They can still be a willing seller. So there's nothing at all to take away from doing something really quick. What asset transfer does give to communities, though, is it gives that ability that if they put forward an asset transfer request, the authority then has to deal with that request and can't dispose of the asset in the interim to any other organisation. So I think that gives a lot of, sort of power to communities to sort of guide and control the conversations. For me, I think the benefit to communities of asset transfer is having that engagement and that better traction with public authorities over access to buildings. And it might be that a lease might be appropriate, it could be that use of a building could be appropriate. Communities tend to have aspirations for ownership and that can bring long-term benefits to them. A lot of the work that we do in High, as I mentioned before, is actually providing the assistance on the funding side to actually enable the purchase to go ahead. And alongside colleagues in the Big Lottery Fund, we administer the Scottish Land Fund on behalf of Scottish Government. And that's a budget of £10 million for this current financial year to really facilitate asset transfer and other purchases, perhaps in the private sector as well. So I think asset transfer does bring benefits. The part of the process, and I was looking at the evidence that DTAS provided following your submission or their evidence session last week, I think it's really vitally important that communities take the time that they need to prepare and to do the relevant business planning. As soon as you take on a lease or particularly ownership, you're then taking on responsibility. So it's important that you actually get the right asset and you've got the means to manage it and to maintain it over long term. And fundamentally, it's all about delivering improved outcomes. There's lots and lots of communities out there across Scotland, a lot of them in the Highlands and Islands, who've actually demonstrated very effectively that this can be done. And I think taking time to prepare and to get all the ducks in a row is actually a very big indicator of that asset then being successfully owned by communities. So it's not a process that you would want to sort of shortcut. It is to look at it openly and to do the proper business planning around that.
Thank you.
Okay, Elaine Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks to the panel for coming to join us. Could I ask a general question to the panel, which perhaps comes in on the back of what Sandra Holmes has just been saying, but while they're thinking about it, I'd like to ask a specific question to Assistant Chief Constable. The general question would be that we've heard in evidence it can be an expensive process for communities to explore an interest in an asset. So at which point would you think that the asset should be frozen? Because some of the concern was that they spend the funding to explore it, to draw up business plans, etc., etc., but before they actually finalise getting the asset, it's already been disposed of. So there must be a point where perhaps it would make sense to freeze that, other than the rules that are there already. But specifically to the Assistant Chief Constable, well, I'll leave that question there. Could I ask, on the police submission, on page 12, Chief Constable, you say that legal clauses will also be required to ensure that a community group cannot obtain premises under the Act and then sell later at a substantial profit. I'd just like to explore that a bit more with you. For example, you may think that some local authorities may have assets that were obtained, so for example, maybe Carnegie Libraries or parts that were gifted to public sector, but then they are sold at a profit into the private sector. So in what way do you think it would be different if a community took on an asset, they shouldn't be allowed to then sell later at a profit? Would it be different if they then were to be putting that profit back into the community? And why is it that public bodies can sell them at substantial profits?
Well, Assistant Chief Constable, come to you last to answer that point, but there was a kind of more general question there. That's good, it gives you more time to think about an answer, Mr. Cowie.
It's gonna be bad.
Who would like to come in first? Sandra Holmes.
Yes, I'll happily speak to that. I'm very comfortable with how asset transfer is provided for in the Act in terms of the point of when it's frozen. We need to get a balance here between the opportunities for communities and also just the day-to-day operation of the public authority in terms of managing its asset portfolio, which in some cases can be quite an active property market in terms of selling things on. And within High, we were, as part of our consultation or contributing to the consultation process, we were keen to put a point to express the need for asset transfer not to interfere with the ongoing property market, because organisations, be it communities or businesses, who are seeking to purchase an asset go through a big process, and if things then get stymied by a late asset transfer requests coming in, once the asset has been marketed, it has got consequences. Because asset transfer is there for communities to act at any time, the idea is that they could then be proactive and engage with us at an early stage, and we would enter into meaningful dialogue. And I think the guidance is quite clear that it does encourage communities to come forward at a pre-application stage, but clearly asset transfer itself doesn't take effect until you get the full asset transfer request. We've also got the community right to buy provisions, which are also open for application to public authority assets. So there's a range of opportunities there for communities to secure assets, but we need to get a balancing act. And I'm certainly comfortable with the way that the this is provided for within the legislation.
Ayoa Colvin, did you want to add anything to that?
It's not really my strong point, but I think I'm thinking
don't,
about
don't
what Sandra's saying.
No,
it's the bit between the operational business and the ability to dispose of estate and also to look at opportunities. And I suppose what I'm thinking is that we are working very much proactively with our local communities to identify need, and you would hope that that would then grow naturally from that work rather than something that suddenly came out of the blue in terms of a request for a community asset transfer.
And it might be very different for health and social care partnership. You don't actually own the assets.
It's a partnership after all.
Bruce Kylo, did you want to add anything?
Just to say, I think part of the responsibility should rest with the organisations like ourselves. I mentioned earlier on about certain assets might appear to be unused, for example, pieces of land, but they might be reserved for some future strategic transport use, a new rail line, new road, whatever it may be. So I think there should be a responsibility in organisations like ourselves to be absolutely clear when we're putting the information on the website, or people are looking up a particular asset or checking what an organisation has available, to be clear about what the future potential uses of that may be, and also the statutory basis for that. Is it included in a local development plan? Is it included in the strategic development plan, our regional transport strategy, etc.? So I think there is, I wouldn't pretend to be an expert in property transactions, but I think there is an opportunity so that communities, when they are bodies, are looking at perhaps looking at our assets, they can see clearly that this may be available, may look available just now, but there is a potential future use of it for a strategic transport reason.
And Richard Davison?
Yeah, nothing much to add, but I think we would certainly agree that the regulations are right in terms of freezing the asset at that particular point. But I think there's quite a lot of this is about providing support to communities in developing their ideas and proposals. And certainly when we have supported community land buyouts in, say, the Outer Hebrides, we have provided quite a lot of environmental advice to help with those community bodies to generate good quality sort of business plans to oversee the transfers of the assets. So I think we have to build that up. And I think the other element is around openness and transparency. This shouldn't really be a closed process, up to the point where the formal request is made. I think it was Rushir Shah at your evidence session last week was calling for more of that sort of openness and transparency. And I think that for us would be the way forward.
Okay, and Sandra Holmes, do you want to come?
Just a very brief comment. We're actually involved in a live case at the moment where we're seeking to dispose of a commercial asset. And I think this is where the sort of public authorities can go beyond what's in the legislation. So within the area where this asset is situated, there's a very active community land-owning development trust. And we have engaged with that development trust to see if they would have any interest in the asset prior to our entering into further discussions with the transfer. So there's things that we can do when we know the communities on the ground, we know what their aspirations are, we know what the local development plans are. So there's some things that we can do where we're actually being proactive, which is beyond what would be required of us within the legislation. And we certainly have embraced those approaches.
Mr. Cowie, we've eventually reached you. I'm sure we'll get a fulsome answer by now.
Grateful.
Yeah.
Is that me now? Is that the nod?
Yes, please. Thank you
very much. Well, I'll give you a simple police officer's answer to that from my understanding of the technicalities. It's, I suppose, to answer your timing question, our experience over the last few years is it takes about 12 to 18 months to start off with the thought that a property may be surplus, then the consultation going through governance, both internally and with the Scottish Police Authority, you're then dependent on market conditions. And that can take a few months, or it can take 18 months, 2 years. So actually the whole process is quite elongated. So actually the guidance talking around freezing something is not particularly hard to bear around that. So that's hopefully the timing question answered. The other one around the I suppose it's the best value aspect. I don't want to talk about specific examples, but perhaps two kind of general comments there. We're going through the thinking that some of our surplus estate, we could get a certain amount back into the public purse and capital receipt if we sell it as is, i.e. an old building that hasn't been used for 2 or 3 years, and the developer then buys it, knocks it down, gets planning consent for a shopping mall, and reaps a huge dividend out of that. Whereas actually with a small bit of investment, if we got the planning permission as the police service and an SPA, then actually the market value of it would be significantly higher. So the public purse would benefit more from there. The other aspect of that is in selling huge capital assets. I have to be careful because some of them are still under kind of negotiation discussion, but they're well known around that. It's a condition of sale is that if the developer buys this massive property and makes a huge profit selling it on within a certain period of time, some of that has to come back to the public purse. So it's more a general comment around that. I suppose kind of translating that into asset transfer requests, it would be about the case would be made by the community body to say that there's public benefit to doing this and taking a lower bid than possibly comes in from a private individual or a company. But it also has to be, you know, in a couple of years' time, if it's sold for significantly more, where has that public benefit gone? And it would just be kind of following that thinking through that we were consistent with that public benefit aspect. It's not sought to be, we're going to use this as a way to say no to everything. Absolutely not. We just want to make sure that the rationale is defensible for any sale.
I think it does need a bit more exploring, just in terms of how that would work with the legal clauses that you mentioned for community groups. If it's actually sold to them, how then they would be paying it back, who they would be paying it back to if they later sold it on. I think that perhaps needs a bit more thinking about. I'm also concerned about the leasing. We also had, if I may, convener, we had some evidence saying that this whole process might, in the asset transfer situation, might make leasing more complicated than it is just now. Would you have any views on that?
Complicated in the sense that obviously the lease is between parties, who's at least from and to, who's applying for it, who's actually holds the lease. So largely that wouldn't be Police Scotland or SPA. We lease properties off other people, so it would just need to be clear in our asset register to community groups that actually there's no point putting time and effort into a bid to lease something that we don't actually own.
Okay. Now, I still have two further questions from members on asset transfer, and can I just say to Ruth McGuire, we are going to move on to planning in a moment, I promise you, but in the meantime, Graham Simpson.
Thanks, it'll be very, very quick. So we took some evidence last week, which basically said that if a public body isn't as engaged as Highlands and Islands Enterprise in this, they could quite easily wriggle out of asset transfer requests. Would you agree with that? And a sort of follow-up question. It kind of goes from what Elaine was saying, and she was suggesting that bodies could make profits. But what if it fails? Who then takes on the asset? You know, if a community body has taken it on and the whole thing collapses.
I see Mr. Kylo and Mr. Davison scribbling away furiously whilst that question has been asked. I don't know if one of you gentlemen would want to come in first, perhaps.
I'm just reminding myself of that, just so I didn't lose track of the question, convener. I think the spirit of the legislation is something that the public bodies have to enter into. I've said earlier on about you know, the cross-boundary nature of transport, the strategic nature, as we're all aware, the long-term nature of some of the projects, that the infrastructure projects that we do. So I think there has to be an acknowledgement that, that, you know, we will be keeping an eye on our assets, also other agencies' assets, councils, etc., for long-term future infrastructure requirements for the transport network that could lead to potential difficulties if they were transferred to community transport bodies. I don't think the spirit of the legislation is there for public bodies to wriggle out of it. I think it has to be the responsibility in the organisation, as other panel members have said, about being transparent, about being open, about being clear on your website or whatever you publish this information, that you may have a future use for it, or another agency may have a future use for it, Transport Scotland, councils, etc., from a transport point of view, Network Rail, etc. So I think that has to be the spirit in which we would enter into it, and being as upfront as we possibly could, as we generally try to do. With regards to the community bodies, when it works and if they make a profit, that's for other people to talk about. But if it fails, I think this is something that we've discussed before. You know, does the responsibility fall back on the agency who sold it to them? Does it fall back in the local council? And obviously, in the current financial climate for local government, things are particularly challenging. But I think that's, again, something that, notwithstanding the resource implications of that in terms of staff, I think as long as there's a good communication between the organisations and a clear monitoring of the use of that asset by the community body who's bought the or taken control of the asset, then that should work. I think it's very much a wait and see for some of this, and we'll just have to look for that in the future.
Mr. Davison?
Yes, I could see, you know, that argument wriggling out, but I think in practice there's at least a couple of things. One is the policy presumption, if you like, behind the legislation is pretty clear, that this is in support of community empowerment, and make it happen. We would very much see community empowerment in terms of sort of asset transfer as being a force for good rather than a negative, because we want to see more communities looking after the environment throughout Scotland. I think where there might be a little bit of an issue is around how an asset transfer request is actually assessed, you know, in terms of, you know, the criteria that are used. You know, in our case, it's hard to think of an example where we would say no, but for example, if a community wanted to buy a piece of land in a nature reserve that was about planting a lot of trees, that was their long-term use, which would otherwise sort of ruin why it is a nature reserve, then that might be a legitimate reason to say, in this form, you know, it's not doable. But I wouldn't class that as wriggling out. That's an honest assessment of what the implications are for why that land is an asset in the first place.
Any other, don't feel compelled if you don't have a particular view on it, any particular comments, Sandra Holmes?
I'll just be brief. In terms of wriggling out, I think the default position is to agree to the request unless you've got justified reasons not to. So it's an open and transparent process. And there's also a very robust appeals process built into the legislation. So if the community organisation isn't satisfied, either because they've been rejected or they don't agree with the terms and conditions that the asset's being offered by the local, the public authority, that they can appeal that. In terms of what happens if it goes into community ownership and then the community ownership organisation suffers some form of failure, I think it's important to realise and accept that failure will happen. It hasn't been a regular occurrence in terms of community asset ownership projects. But in terms of what would happen to the assets, it really depends on how the organisation is its governing documents, how it's constituted. And normally what would happen once all the liabilities are dealt with, depending on what's in the constitution, it would usually be that the asset would transfer to a similar organisation. And depending if the organisation's been set up to comply with various parts of the Land Reform Act, ministers would have a role in determining what that organisation might be. So it's no different to any other organisation that they'll have dissolution clauses and the assets would have to be accounted for. But it isn't a regular occurrence, but it's not to say it doesn't happen.
Any additional comments from witnesses on that? Mr. Simpson, do you want to follow up on any of that?
What if there isn't a similar organisation to step in?
Sometimes
opposition, depending on how the organisation is set up, that it could fall back to Scottish ministers.
So obviously, we can ask more information about when we have them here. The final question on asset transfer, even if you then provoke lots of other questions from members, so we can move on to something else. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. Just a brief question on registers of land. Under Section 94, you have a duty to publish, to establish and maintain a register of land. I'm just wondering if everyone's on time for that, for the 23rd of January, and if there are any issues around that. And secondly, a very specific question for Highlands and Isles Enterprise. You have a large area of land, the Cairngorm Estate, which you leased to a company called Natural Retreats since 2014. I'm just wondering, in that context, was there any attempt to do an asset transfer or not?
So we'll answer that question last, perhaps, just the same we did with Mr. Cowie, but a more general question about register of land, Richard Davison?
Yes, back for completing that.
Okay, yes. Bruce Kylo, yes. Just for the record, I see nodding heads, I think. I own it. It might not be your organisation because you don't hold assets.
Well, just that I am I'm also director of the health board and of the council.
Right.
So the answer is yes for both, I would expect, yes.
So depending what hat you're wearing, the answer is
yes. Okay. Unless it's the IJB hat, in which the answer is it's nothing to do with me.
Right. Okay, that's helpful. Andy Cowie.
Yes, we're on track with that, yeah.
Sorry, Sandra Holmes, I thought you'd have more time to craft an answer there. Ms. Holmes.
Yes, I wasn't close to this, Mr. Whiteman, but the land that we've got at Cairngorm also includes the funicular. And we're quite a localised organisation, that we've got local area teams, and our local area team will have engaged with the local community. From memory, I don't think there was any desire from within the community to get involved in that process in terms of taking on the asset and delivering it. But out with this, I'll just check that and come back to you with more detail.
Okay. Mr. Whiteman, anything in addition to that? The very patient Ruth Maguire.
Convener, good morning, everyone. I'd like to hear a bit about part two now, the community planning aspect of things. And firstly say that I welcome there's going to be a specific focus on tackling inequality. And I guess that will sit more comfortably with some organisations than others, so I'd be keen to hear your thoughts on that. The other bit I would like to hear from you on is that CPPs will be at quite different places around the country, I imagine, and there may still be a need for a bit of a culture change within some. So it was just to hear your reflections on whether there was a need for more clarity around accountability and performance amongst partners within the CPP.
Okay, who'd like to start us off on that? Mr. Davison, you're making eye contact with me. Yes, Richard Davison.
At the wrong time. in terms of inequalities, you might think Scottish Natural Heritage, sort of particularly urban community planning partnerships, where a lot of inequalities do exist, why would we wish to be involved? But we see urban populations and improving access to good quality nature and green space as being vitally important to reducing some of the inequalities, for example, around health and physical activity, for example. So we very much welcome the focus on inequalities. It's not without challenges for an organisation like SNH, where a lot of our staff resource and funding is out with urban areas, but we are sort of moving towards, for example, our ERDF Green Infrastructure Project, which is looking at ways of improving the quality of green space in some of the poorer sections, areas of Scotland. In terms of existing community planning partnerships, although we haven't been a statutory community planning partner until this new act coming in, we have recognised for a long time the value of getting involved in community planning partnerships and trying to put the environment into their thinking, their agendas, their priorities, so basically showing how nature can help deliver health benefits. So it's not necessarily about getting an environmental outcome into a LOIP or a locality plan or whatever, or a single outcome agreement to date. Even without being a statutory partner, we have been engaged to a greater or lesser extent through groups or even full membership of community planning partnership boards, with about 15 community planning partnerships out of the 32. So over a period of time, we would expect that to steadily increase as the governance core of the community planning partnership started to bring in what are now statutory community planning partners. So we stand ready to support that.
Bruce Kylo, did you want to add anything?
Thanks, Convener. I think it's very much accepted now that transport can play one of the main roles in tackling inequality and ensuring that the most deprived areas of our communities can have the same access to opportunities as others, and that's something that we in SPT are continually focused on, particularly when bus services may be withdrawn. There's no services after 6 o'clock or at the weekend. So that's something that we are focused on, and that can sometimes be a very local issue, but it also can have an impact on the much wider transport network. So again, I just make a plea really that the understanding of the strategic regional nature, cross-boundary nature of transport is there, just like inequality. It doesn't observe local authority boundaries or wards or whatever the locality areas that we're talking about. I'm guided that there's around about 30 local outcome improvement areas across six councils so far in the west of Scotland. I think we'd be looking, convener, at providing very much a regional response to some of that, just so that people can get the bigger picture of what's happening in their wider area as well as specifically in the local area. I think from our point of view with regards to community planning, I think, like anything, there's always an opportunity for greater transparency, greater accountability. But we've benefited from community planning. I was talking with Iona earlier on that there's dialogue going on between our organisations about improving transport access to healthcare in her area. And that's the type of thing that comes out of community planning, is as long as it's followed up and there's a formal process just to make sure that action is taken forward. You'll also be aware that one of our big things is over the last 2 or 3 years has been the West of Scotland Community Transport Network. Hugely useful way of adding to the transport network, particularly for those deprived areas, very much community-led, and something that we've been able to promote and really sell at the community planning partnerships across the West of Scotland. The West of Scotland Community Transport Network is the first of its kind in Scotland, and it sets the standard that we expect from community transport operators and allows us to invest in them. So there's huge opportunities that have come out of community planning that I think we could build on for the future, and we most certainly will try to do that.
Iona, would you like to add anything, just give a name check there?
It's a good example. I think in terms of, I really welcome this, I keep going to call you Councillor Maguire, Ruth, because I think it's in health and social care, often what we're dealing with is, not trying to teach granny to suck eggs here, but often what we're dealing with is the consequence of inequalities. And I think one of the things that we're doing and working with the IGIB and in partnership with community planning is highlighting the consequences of those inequalities for our communities, in which in an area like North Ayrshire or East Ayrshire or even South Ayrshire are quite different in each of our communities. And we have an area, for example, where one part of the community is relatively well off but lives longer, and another part of our area where basically people suffer ill health for long periods of time. And that has meant that the demand on health and social care is phenomenal, and the increase in demand that we've seen over the last couple of years has been really quite remarkable. And part of that is, as we work through in terms of the community planning partnership and looking at what we can do, is about unearthing that and showing it for what it is, and then working with other community planning partners to say, what are you going to do about it? Because this is not just about health and social care responses. Actually, it's about transport. Actually, it's about people getting jobs, because we know that when people get jobs, that apart from we do have an issue with low income, clearly, but when people get jobs, then their health and their well-being improves and the health and well-being of their children improves. Actually, it's about childcare, it's about education, it's about attainment, and it's about all of those things. And so in North Ayrshire, we've developed what we're calling Fair for All, which is a health, which is an inequality strategy, which actually puts the demands on all the community planning partnerships to look at those issues through the issues that we have through the inequalities lens to say, is this going to make it better or worse for people? Are we going to improve the situation for people who are the worst off and who are most excluded across the area? And how do we actually try in an area which has suffered badly through the recession, how are we actually trying to shift the position that we need to shift for those people who are experiencing the worst of the inequalities gap?
Okay, thank you. Sandra Holmes, do you want to add anything in relation to equality?
Yes, just to say that the inclusion agenda is very relevant to the work of HAI. For us, it's often looking at disparity of opportunity across our region and looking at our more remote rural communities. Often inequality is a multitude of factors, and it's very deep-rooted. And as has been mentioned previously, you know, these are issues that we can't overcome in isolation. This is where community planning can make a big difference, focusing on inequalities. HAI doesn't tend to engage with individuals or service users that are at extreme risk, but we contribute to the wider environment to try and create better opportunities through employment, through social enterprise, etc., to provide wider opportunities to help bring people out of disadvantage.
Yeah, Andy Cowie.
Yeah, just I'll echo Sandra's comments. Obviously, being responsible for policing from Perth North, I will have a perspective which reflects that rural deprivation can be different from urban deprivation, but just equally impactful. And that's one of the challenges, I suppose, as we take forward locality planning, in that the definition in the Act, about 30,000 people, is a difficult one. So if you take a Shetland example, their locality that they feel is the most unequal and poor outcomes are the more remote islands within Shetland, but they nowhere near get to 30,000 people. But they still feel that they should be using the principles of the Act to address that. So the vulnerabilities focus of Police Scotland moving forward will very much pick up and emphasise that outcomes and inequalities piece, because 80% of our calls are not crime related. They're about vulnerability, whether they're missing people, mental health, or repeat victimisation. So that's very much in our sights around that vulnerability and inequality bit. And the second part of your question, if I recall it correctly, was around accountability. As you'll expect within a hierarchical organisation, accountability is one of our watchwords. And if I can anchor it maybe around an example in Perth and Kinross, they've identified 5 localities within the Community Planning Partnership. They've renamed the local Community Planning Partnership as an action partnership, to just to focus everybody's mind on what it's actually about is action, not just talking around it. And one of our local chief inspectors, she's responsible for chairing one of the action partnerships. So not just a police-only function, right across the board. So they're working with the Community Choices Fund, which is obviously funded from yourselves, matched by the local authority. So they're doing all the participatory budgeting piece. And they also have our locality team. So we have identifiable officers from constable, sergeant, inspector, etc., all accountable and named around taking forward some of those actions. So it's developmental for our staff, but it's also, we think, that's where our organisational effort and energy should be focused in delivering. And that's just one example. We could give you very many more across Scotland.
Thank you for those answers. I just want to come back to the rest of the panel on that point of accountability and performance, and hear if they think there's need for a bit of clarity around that, because it's good to hear that everyone is working well and hear the good examples of where it is working and making a difference. But do you think on that specific point there's more needed, or are you comfortable that the public would be content with the arrangements as they are, seeing you all work together?
Are you on a call?
Yeah, well, the outcome for improving inequality sits with the health and social care partnerships, and it's a national outcome against which we are measured, and it's always been one that's troubled me somewhat because of what I said earlier, which is that whilst there are some things we can do through health and social care, and particularly through health, if we think about health improvement type activity, it very much needs to be done with the rest of the public bodies. And so I think that we're looking at how we line line up those outcomes in relation to the LOIP so that we make sure that actually that outcome, from my point of view, in terms of improving inequalities, actually sits with the wider community planning partnership as well as with health and social care. Not that I'm trying to duck the outcome, because I'm not, but it is. I know that more jobs in North Ayrshire will make more difference than more healthcare. We know that, but it does need to be, I think, very clear in terms of the focus. And it's not an easy area to tackle either, because the research is kind of mixed. There are areas where we know that if we take certain action, we will make a difference, and it's very much about that. And I think that's been the focus in North Ayrshire, and I think in East Ayrshire as well, in terms of looking at where did you make a difference. So some of it is transport. So what we do with our roads, what we do with transport, all of that does actually has been proven to make a difference in terms of the inequalities agenda. And I've obviously mentioned jobs, but and the position of particularly of women and the issue around childcare, which obviously the government is trying to tackle just now as well, obviously does make a difference. So for me, I welcome that fact that we will all have some responsibility in terms of incorporation of some of these of some of the individual outcomes into the wider outcomes for the community planning partnership.
And Ilona Colvin happily signposted Bruce Kylo during that answer. I wonder what he made a comment in relation to accountability.
Yeah, absolutely, convener. I think that there's the need to do that is never greater, considering the amount of resource that is perhaps less available now for local government and partners like ourselves and working with colleagues in, like Iona and others in health boards and councils. We need to maximise the return for our investment. If I can say, our budget for example, supporting local bus services has remained broadly static for round about the last few years, around about £12 million a year. Still a significant amount of money, but we've done various things to try and make that stretch further, and we have got the facts and figures now to back up what's happened there. I believe our My Bus service, our demand responsive transport service, with over 500,000 passengers a year, easily the most popular DRT service in Scotland and one of the best in the UK, and it shows the demand that's out there. But you can see the wider, much wider benefits, I think, and this is perhaps an area for greater work. Those people using our My Bus service are getting out and about. They're going to the shops, going to the bingo, doing various other things which will be having a huge impact on their mental health and their physical health, being able to socialise with people. And that's perhaps an area that could be improved in terms of the impact of transport. I mentioned earlier on the argument that transport is good for reducing inequality. I think that's been won, but I think we need to move it to the next stage and start to look at some of these things, the wider impacts of transport on our communities. It is a derived demand. People want to go to a place to go and do something. And how can the work that we do in transport access to healthcare, what positive benefit is that having beyond just getting somebody to the place that they're going? That's perhaps an area, convener, that could be improved in terms of monitoring and accountability and performance.
Okay, thank you. I'm conscious, don't feel the need to, but Mr. Davis and Ms. Holmes hasn't responded in relation to that. Do you want to add anything?
I think the only thing that I would add is obviously the benefit, if you like, of the changes under the Community Empowerment Act is to broaden the range of organisations that are classed as statutory community planning partners. And I think there'll be a sort of a period when sort of existing community planning partnerships come to terms with that and how they sort of bring in these wider partners. Obviously, as I mentioned earlier, for some community planning partnerships, we're already heavily involved. But for a number of others, we've had very little, if any, involvement. I suppose one of the tests from our point of view is how does that sort of relationship, that arrangement, change over a period of time? But I don't think that needs formal review sort of built in. I think that'll be picked up over time, I would have thought.
Sandra Holmes, you want to add anything?
Yes, just very briefly. I think that community planning is now shared in terms of its responsibility across all partners clearly supports accountability. But also the outcome-focused approach, community planning partners will have to set out the difference that they intend to achieve at 1, 3, and 10 year sort of cycles and to report on progress towards that. So I think that's a very helpful way to help demonstrate accountability in active monitoring and reporting back, and then taking step changes to ensure that things are still on track to deliver the outcomes.
Okay. Can we maybe just, we're coming to the end of our time, but there was one question I think we should ask, because it was a theme in last week's evidence session, and that was around participation requests. And there's a number of questions we can ask in relation to that, but we won't because of time. But there was a feeling that there has to be a structure to participation requests, but we have to be careful that there's still flexibility in the system, because there's lots of groups and organisations already working very well with the organisations here and others, and we wouldn't want participation requests to be seen as so rigid that could actually exclude or dissuade folk that already, or organisations and community groups that are already in the system, from not participating. I suppose if you were to be cynical about it, not that I am being, of course, but once you struck, not you personally, once those participation requests are so structured, then if you don't follow the rules as rigidly set out, then you can actually deny the participation to certain organisations and groups. So any comments you have about how bodies such as your own should handle participation requests and the regulations and guidelines that will be coming into force would be welcome, because that would tie in with last week's evidence. Anyone in relation to that? Bruce Kylo.
Yeah, thanks, Kavina. I think the principle of participation requests, as you're saying, is very much difficult to deny. But I think from our point of view, being a regional organisation, I keep bringing up this regional strategic thing, just because we do cover 12 council areas, we do cover 2.14 million people. And, for example, there's round about 81 active community councils in one local authority area in Glasgow. So the concern from our point of view would be the impact of if we were doing a fairly major project. You'll be aware of smart card ticketing, the subway modernisation, etc. Fairly big projects, Fastlink, others that we've been involved in over the years. Fairly big projects. If there was a series of participation requests, would it perhaps led to an overwhelming amount coming in from the resource that we've got in terms of staff time to be able to assist those people in doing their, in participating in it? I think that's where our biggest concern would come. And again, as I said earlier on with regard to the locality planning, we would seek to find a way where we could work with those organisations, perhaps on a regional basis through another forum. We're very keen the way that we work just now with local communities, both in terms of direct consultation with them, for example, in relation to the subway modernisation, accessibility impacts with disabled people. We do try to work with them as best we can in a way that suits them and also suits us. And I think the reality of that is something that we'll be trying to put into the participation request. We do engage with local communities all the time just now, but we would be fearful, I think, of an overwhelming amount of participation requests coming in for particular projects. And I think we would seek to try and do that on a regional basis.
Okay, thank you. And before I take the rest of the witnesses in, this will probably be, you might be relieved to hear, your last opportunity to make a comment. So if there's anything else you want to draw to the committee's attention, now would be a good time to do it. We'll wrap it up in the next few minutes or so. So I will take all of you, because whether you want to reply to participation requests or not, it'll be your final chance to give a comment to the committee. So Richard Davison.
I think to a large extent, I think this actually increases pressure might not be quite the right word, but pressure on public bodies around informal approaches and actually engaging much more with communities around the services that they provide. At the end of the day, I think, there's part of me that almost thinks that if community bodies have to go through the full process of a participation request, there's something that might not be quite right in how those services are designed and delivered in the first place. So certainly our approach to it is around that sort of being more positive, more proactive around that informal end. So just to illustrate that with an example, we're aware that we've got, Scottish Government have asked us to lead the implementation of what's called the route map for the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy to 2020. And we're aware that there's quite a lot of disengagement around biodiversity issues with young people. So we've been working with Young Scot on setting up a National Youth Advisory Panel to guide us on what would work from their point of view, what connections to make around young people and biodiversity and improving outcomes from that work for young people. Now, that hasn't required a formal participation request, but it's an example, I think, of how public organisations have to work more creatively, more imaginatively with communities. I think just one final point. This goes back a little bit, I suppose, to the community planning, but one of the things that we'd be particularly looking for out of community planning is around the placemaking sorts of approaches. So really combining, if you like, at a local level, what is being done through community planning and what is being done through spatial development planning. And I think there's a real advantage in bringing those closer together.
Okay, thank you. Maybe Andy Cowie?
Evidence from Christie shows that the more you involve people in decision making around the service design and delivery, the better it is. Whether it's community resilience, dealing with flooding, right up to the routine stuff. So we're absolutely keen to do that, both externally and also internally with our own staff. Having come through the trauma of a merger, we're now emerging from the other side of that, driving forward, and it's about empowering our staff as well to be more involved with our communities. So we already have, at constable level, people going to community councils to give reports, to take feedback, and we would see this as just another aspect of that. But I suppose picking up the point from earlier, some of the participation requests may come in if a service is seen to be failing to deliver outcomes, because already it's a fairly broad church around people participating at that local level. So we have to be very careful, and that's where the accountability comes in the annual report. Are we actually delivering that service? But no, absolutely comfortable. We see it as a big opportunity for us as we move forward.
Thank you very much, Sandra Holmes.
In terms of participation requests, I think this is an area that High feels we do a lot already, but we can always do more. We're very connected to our communities. We've got a very strong local presence, so people can get engaged with somebody at a local level they perhaps know already. Many of our communities are already very empowered, and I think the test for us here will be to see how participation requests can hopefully reach out to some communities that perhaps feel less able to engage in the process. But I think the point that you raised about it would be a shame if participation requests made something more complex, for us it's all about having constructive dialogue in an approach that's appropriate for the community, and us taking steps to ensure that we make that easy and transparent for them.
Thank you very much. And finally, Iona Colvin.
In terms of participation requests, I mean, I'd love to say that I think, we're working so well with our communities that basically we'll be anticipating all the participation requests. But given that this applies to communities of interest as well as geographical communities, I think that it is inevitable that there may well be some conflicting views at some point. I'm thinking, for example, that we've just done consultation around changes to learning disability services, and what you see there is very different views between younger parents of young people with learning disability and older parents in terms of the types of services and the approach that should be taken. So I think that it is likely that there will be some disagreements. I think the issue for us is how we deal with that as transparently as we can, and that we need to set that out transparently, and that everybody needs to feel that their view has been heard. For me, the bit of work that really we need to do and we need to think through quite quickly is the interface between the two pieces of legislation around the Public Bodies Act and that desire to include the people who use and provide health and social care services, and the Community Empowerment Act. And that, for me, is something that we probably need to work through quickly in terms of making sure that we merge everything together. Thank you very much.
No, thank you. Can I thank all our witnesses? And I want to call on that particular point. Time has defeated us just now this afternoon. We've just gone 12 o'clock. Do contact us if there's more information you want us to have in relation to that. Indeed, that's an offer to all the witnesses as we continue evidence in relation to statutory instruments for the Community Empowerment Act. Can I just also put on the record, before we move into private session, that the committee will hear from the Minister for Local Government and Housing, Kevin Stewart, at its meeting on the 30th of November to consider these statutory instruments further. Can I thank you again for your attendance this morning, and we now move into private session. Thank you.